Let me welcome everyone to this, our final Stegner Center presentation for this academic year, the spring semester of 2016. I guess for the last time, I'll introduce myself as Bob Keiter, director of the Wallace Stegner Center. That is the last time this semester. And we're very pleased to have with us two young but accomplished individuals who have some important things to share with us. Before introducing them, let me begin by thanking the Cultural Vision Fund, which has quite generously provided funding for our Stegner Center lecture series and today's presentation, as well as funding for the Stegner Center Annual Symposium and our Young Scholar Program. The Cultural Vision Fund is actually the founding donor for that program. We will launch again a new set of green bags and lectures in the fall, so please join us and stay tuned for announcements regarding those programs. Right now, we're going to hear about the Greater Yellowstone Migrations Project. Joe Riis, the photographer in this project, is a National Geographic contributing photographer. He's also a fellow at the Wyoming Migration Initiative. He's been working in the Greater Yellowstone area since 2008. He's traversed much of this country, including the rugged Absaroka Range. We'll hear more about that, and has spent eight-plus years working on wildlife migration and photographing them. Some of you may recall that we had Joe with us a couple of years ago when he documented the path of the pronghorn wildlife migration corridor in western Wyoming. He's joined today by his colleague, Arthur Middleton, who's a research scientist at the Yale School of Forestry and Environmental Studies. He's also a research associate at the Wyoming Migration Initiative and the Draper Museum of Natural History, which is located at the Buffalo Bill Center of the West in Cody, Wyoming. Arthur completed his Ph.D. 4 years ago at the University of Wyoming, where he studied the interactions of wolves and elk along the Absaroka Range, and also developed relationships with folks living in the communities along the Absaroka Front. He's destined in mid-2016, this year, for a new position in wildlife ecology, management, and policy at the University of California in Berkeley. It's my pleasure and the Stegner Center's pleasure to welcome Joe and Arthur, and I'm going to turn the program over to you. Thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Bob, and thank you, Jan, for having us here. It's wonderful to be here again. I was here in 2012 talking about pronghorn, and there's been a lot happened since then. I've been photographing other things and photographing mule deer and elk, and the main thing is I've been working a lot more with scientists lately, people like Arthur Middleton. And so it's been a really nice transition for me. And so the Greater Yellowstone Ecosystem, that's where I've been working lately, and it begs the question, well, what is an ecosystem?
So you guys are going to get to see me and Joe talking for one of the first times together. We're probably going to step on each other's toes. It'll be like a high school dance.
Yeah.
Awkward kind of a thing. But so we work. The two of us have been working over almost a decade, first together, or first apart, now together, in the Greater Yellowstone. This is the home of our first national park, 1872, world's first national park. Vast landscape, rugged mountains to plains, and this is a place where we have increasingly been focused on the ecology of large mammals that migrate, hoofed mammals known as ungulates. that we have focused on using particular tools of our trades. For Joe, it's the camera trap. And for me, it's the GPS collar. And so we benefited from this incredible revolution in technology that's allowing us to see something that we've known about in the Greater Yellowstone for many, many years. In fact, since not long before it was established, when wildlife started to rebound and we could see their movements and migrations in glimpses. But it's something that people really just aren't able to see. This is not an easy phenomenon to witness. And so much of our work is now documenting this phenomenon and trying to bring our work to the point that we can share it with a broader public, because we feel like these are animals that have a lot to tell us about Yellowstone, about what we increasingly know of as the Greater Yellowstone Ecosystem, and about how we are going to need to evolve our management and policy of this place if we want to sustain what's so extraordinary about it. And so I'm going to let Joe tell you a little bit about his work in this place. I think,
yeah. So my journey with migration started in South Dakota, where I grew up. And I grew up in a family where we hunted and fished for our food, and that's where it all began, was with those geese on the left that I grew up hunting. I always wondered, well, where are they coming from and where are they going? And that was instilled in me at a pretty young age. And then I went to school at the University of Wyoming, wildlife biology, and graduated. Wasn't sure what I was going to do, and that's when I moved into the back of my truck and decided to photograph pronghorn for 2 years. And because I didn't know what else to do, and it sounded like a good idea. So that's what I did. And these are GPS points from about 5 pronghorn on that famous path of the pronghorn. This is a herd of about 400 animals, and they had never been photographed before. And I hadn't ever photographed before either. I could barely take a good selfie, as you can see. But over the course of that 2 years, I started to put some pictures together that looked like migration, that was migration. And this is when I started to realize, well, I need to use camera traps. I need to document something that we essentially can't see for the most part, because if we're there, the animals aren't there. So that's when I started to use this thing called a camera trap, which is setting up a camera and then it's triggered by motion. And then I started to get some video clips and pictures that really get at the essence of this movement, where you see large groups of animals moving together. They all have the same thing in mind, and they're going to do it if they can. And then I started to put camera traps in, you know, at the river crossings and at the other places where it really looks like migration. It is migration. They're only in these places when they're migrating. And it's that picture in the bottom right with the shadow that really launched my career. And that's where I got introduced to the Geographic. And that is a gift. I mean, that entire 2 years is worth this single moment of time. And of course, I was, you know, starting to document the other things that were benefiting from the migration. And the main thing was, after I moved there and was living in places like this, I started to realize that, you know, these are some of the, here's, you know, where some of the impacts are happening, and I needed to document that. Some of the subdivisions that the pronghorn are moving through, this small herd of 400 are moving through. And of course, these are what people need to see, I think. And it brings us to fences. And the fences, I mean, there's a lot of fences in the West. They create stresses on migrating animals. We don't really know what the limits are that the animals can take. Sometimes these these things like fences cause mortality. Here's a famous place called Trapper's Point, which is a bottleneck just to the west of Pinedale, Wyoming. This picture's from 2008. This was a pretty common scene in the fall time as they're heading south with the snow. But in 2012, there was a highway overpass that was built, and this was built by the government, the Wyoming Department of Transportation. There was a lot of people involved, a lot of nonprofits, a lot of locals, all the agencies, but the bottom line is the public perception changed and the government built overpasses, which now is a, you know, it's a complete success, and everybody should be proud of it. And but that whole entire time I was working there, I realized there were some deer, but I didn't really think deer were that cool, that important, and I had my pronghorn sunglasses on, and that's what I was looking for, that's what I was trying to document. And I never really noticed, but the entire time, essentially underneath, you know, I just couldn't see it, there was this mule deer migration of 5,000 mule deer happening almost in the exact same place, which to me is incredible. And this migration was discovered in 2012 by a researcher named Hall Sawyer, who also did his work on the pronghorn migration for his master's degree in the late 90s. And so he called me up and said, "Hey, I just discovered this mule deer migration. Do you want to photograph it?" And of course, I was in like, "Yes, that sounds wonderful." And it brought me back to this area. And that was after I talked here. And this is one of the most famous, or it's probably the most well-known migration that goes from mountains to plains in the world. The way up in the Hoback Basin, up in the high country, almost at 11,000 feet. And then they head down into the Red Desert and bump up against I-80, just to the east of here. And the thing about this migration for me as a photographer was they're crossing the lake outlets of all these finger lakes that are on the west side of the Wind River Range. So that's where I focused a lot of my energy to show migration. And this project was kind of my first try at, to where I was spending a lot of time doing video camera work. Essentially, I spend a lot of time trying to capture these little moments in time. And they cross three major highways, and they cross a little over 100 fences, 105 fences, I think, one way is what they cross. And of course, some of them don't make it. And so this project was my first project where I worked directly with a scientist. And the scientist, Hall Sawyer, who's with the Wyoming Migration Initiative, he produced this thing called a migration assessment, where he listed the top 10 problematic places and then essentially mapped the entire migration. And it's a wonderful document. And then I produced the pictures for it, and then him and I also produced a short film, a four-minute film. And at the time, I didn't think there would be much interest in deer, just because they're such a common animal. But we produced a film, and on one of the sites we put it on, I mean, we have almost 4 million views, which to me is incredible that there's that much interest. And then, so the number one place on the migration assessment is this bottleneck right here by the town of Pinedale. And as you can see here, the amount of different land management, I mean, it's incredible. It spans everything pretty much. We got Park Service, Forest Service, private, state, and BLM. So this pinch point right to the north of the town of Pinedale. The town of Pinedale is right here, and there's houses in here. And there's houses here along the lake. Well, all 5,000 of those mule deer moved through right here. And there was a proposed housing development, a 350-acre housing development in here proposed that, you know, it threatened the corridor. And I mean, all this was a pinch point, and it could have cut it off. And last year, the Conservation Fund, with help from the Knobloch Family Foundation, purchased this piece of property for, I think, $1.7 million, and then they're in the process of turning it over to the Wyoming Game and Fish Department. This chunk of ground is now protected, and here's a video clip from that exact spot. So if you can imagine a house right where that sun is, that was very likely. And that won't happen now. Arthur.
So, when I, Joe was doing all this work, starting to do this work with my colleague, Hal Sawyer, I was freezing my face off up in Cody, Wyoming, as a grad student working on my Ph.D. research. And I guess what I want to say is I was an audience of Joe's work. I was an audience member, and yet kind of preoccupied with other things, but keeping track of this pretty extraordinary stuff that was going on to the south of where I was working. I, on the other hand, had come to that place to try and understand the interactions of wolves and elk in the northwest part of Wyoming. I, as a kid, when I was, I think, 12 years old, had gone to the bookstore, seen this book right here. I'm sure many of you have seen it, maybe read it. Was obsessed with wolves, begged for the money to buy this book, bought this book, read it even though it was all way over my head. And I guess something got kind of lodged in me that drew me to this work that I eventually ended up doing, which is an incredible thing. I got to go be a part of this ecosystem and work on this animal. Starting in 2007, and so it was the wolf that kind of brought me to the West and to the Greater Yellowstone. And what I was studying was how wolves influence these elk scattered around the winter ranges, particularly in the northwest Wyoming, but on the east side of Yellowstone itself. And in particular, how wolves influence the behavior and movements of these animals, wolf predation, and how that influences these populations in winter. The herd that I was focused on was the Clark's Fork herd. Cody, Wyoming would be just to the south of, I guess our laser isn't working, just to the south of the Clark's Fork herd I'm showing you here. And you're seeing GPS movements of about of a representative sample of the animals that I collared in this herd as a part of this work. You can see they migrate from winter ranges out on the edge of the ecosystem up, and they're moving up several thousand feet into the upper Lamar in the northeast portion of Yellowstone National Park for their summer, which is a movement of about, depending on which winter range they start from, between 40 and 60 miles. And what was happening in this herd that prompted the research that I was a part of with the Wyoming Game and Fish Department and the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service was the decline in black dots here. What you're seeing is the decline of the number of calves every year in this 5,000-member Clark's Fork elk herd. So on the y-axis is the number of calves per 100 cows in this elk herd, and you can see compared with elk that don't migrate, the ones that do are steadily declining in terms of their production of calves. Outwardly, that seemed, you know, it was very coincident with wolf reintroduction, so outwardly it seemed very related to the presence of wolves on these winter ranges. And I began this work at a time when this was the milieu into which I sort of entered. Wolves, 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 wolves all the time. Wolves, They are government-sponsored terrorists. They are bringing back the ecosystem. They're the biggest story in Yellowstone in decades. And so it was very natural to look very closely at the role of wolves. The thing is, and I should say, everybody wanted to do that, you know, between whether it's a state wildlife agency or fellow ecologists to locals, everybody's focused on the role of wolves. Whichever direction you're coming from, it's, well, what's the role of wolves? But remember, this herd migrates away for the summer into the northeast corner of Yellowstone National Park. When they do that, they sort of go behind this, you know, what we might call a wilderness curtain. They go away from where we can see them and count them and study them and into a place where we typically don't pay much attention to them, in the deep backcountry of Yellowstone. And so a lot of my work took me into that backcountry zone to ask questions about, well, what's happening to these elk calves when they are born and spend the summer on these summer ranges. And what we saw was a couple of key things I want to tell you. First, and I don't have my laser here, but if you look at this top figure, one of the things I was using was satellite imagery that lets us see greenness accumulate and decline over the course of the seasons. So that green line is the green grass coming on in spring, hanging around a while, and then turning brown down into the winter. For these migratory elk, just like any migrating herbivore, it's that green up, that period on the left-hand side of that curve that's really important. It's when that tender new grass is emerging in the spring and early summer, and it's highly digestible, and that's what gets you fat. And so that's why you're migrating. Well, what we saw over the course of 20 years prior to this period in which I was working, so on the bottom left here, you're looking at the duration in weeks on the y-axis, and on the x is time. The duration in weeks over 20 years of the length of the growing season, of that period of green up. And what we saw was a 40% decrease in the duration of the growing season. And how that manifested was it affected the ability of those female elk to nurse their calves and get pregnant again for the next year. And so why were the elk calf numbers declining? Well, one reason was that fewer elk were being born into the world. And the second, well, now I got two of these to manage. Well, once they were born, very conveniently, some colleagues of mine had been studying predation patterns of experienced by elk on their summer ranges. And what those folks were finding was, in spite of the fact that everybody pays attention to wolves and seeks to find a role of these reintroduced wolves in the dynamics of these elk herds, it's bears that are doing most of this predation. So here you're looking at the percent. If you put tags, VHF collars on 100 newborn elk and watch their fates over the course of the early summer, what happens to them? 40% of them get eaten by bears within the first 3 weeks of their lives. And there's not a whole lot left over for wolves to eat. And so my point here is that when we actually followed these animals to where they spent half their year in another part of the landscape, we could see very different influences on their population. We could see a combination of drought, an effect of the most severe drought that the system has experienced in at least 135 years, the hottest temperatures in 6,000 years, and predation by particularly bears. And so it was understanding migration, following migration, that helped me as an ecologist understand how important that phenomenon is to this ecosystem. If you don't understand migration, you're going to misunderstand really important things about what's happening with key members of this ecological system. And so, at the same time, over the course of my work, I was realizing just how important migration was. Why do these animals migrate? They migrate to go up into this high country and get that new tender green grass. And when they can migrate, that allows them, generally when we're not in a drought, to get fatter, to produce more offspring, and to be more abundant. And that's our, for many, many years, what people who have studied migration have understood to be its main benefit. It lets you get fat and produce a lot of calves, and migratory herds as a result can be more abundant than resident herds. That allows them to feed things like grizzly bears, these wolves that we run into on the trail in the Greater Yellowstone. And it's also, if you spend a lot of time outside the park in places like Cody, where we do a lot of our work, something that sustains a really important part of the local economy, and that's outfitting, hunting, recreation, tourism. These animals move into the park, they feed this incredible engine of carnivore and scavenger diversity, they come back out and they're feeding into local economies in very important ways. And so I was beginning to see a phenomenon in migration which we needed to understand as fundamental to Yellowstone, but also we hadn't seen to date very well. And as a person who had been consuming Joe's work for several years, I wanted to team up with him. And so we started to do that. And so what we're going to do next is we're going to take you on the journey that we've been on for the past 2 years together, documenting the elk migrations of the Greater Yellowstone. And before we jump into that journey, I want to tell you one other thing that was motivating for both of us about in doing this work. Right here, you're looking at the view across the Pitchfork Ranch and the Grable River of northwest Wyoming, which is several valleys south of where you saw the Clark's Fork herd migrating a few minutes ago. The migrations of these animals mean that for half the year, even though we associate them very profoundly with Yellowstone, they're not in Yellowstone. They're out on private lands, dependent on whatever people have got going on those private lands. And that seems like a very, very important thing for people to understand about Yellowstone. And so, for my part, what I was interested in doing at the beginning of this work was finding out what the other migrations of elk were in this ecosystem. I had studied one, but I had this sense that there were many others. And I quickly found that there wasn't a map of that. I couldn't go anywhere and get a detailed, comprehensive map of this fundamental ecological process in the Greater Yellowstone. And so I set about, with agency colleagues who had already documented some of these migrations, gathering that information if it already existed, and then also going out when I found gaps and doing new collaring of herds that we didn't have detailed movement data for. And so one of the first herds that we turned our attention to in this process was the Cody elk herd. Now we're just to the south of Cody. Now that I have this thing, I can point it out to you. Cody, Wyoming sits right about here. This is the Grable River Valley, the South Fork of the Shoshone. The Cody herd, like the Clark's Fork herd, winters out on these private, mixed private and public lands and moves between 70 and 80 miles into the core wilderness of the Greater Yellowstone. Their modest area in the lower 48, or one of them, the Thoroughfare Valley. And so Joe and I set out to follow this herd. And this was the beginning of our effort together over the past few years. Those migrations began down on the private lands, like you see here, where there's the gradual the gradual step, slow but steady, of development on these winter ranges of these herds. We have scattered oil development. This is out on the Pitchfork Ranch in a state-owned piece of land within the ranch. About 300 oil wells in the Grable River Valley that these elk encounter in the course of their winter. Other kinds of developments, housing. This is a funny one. This is actually a monastery that's currently being put up in the Cody Herd's winter range. And in the course of this work, we encounter people.
All ranchers will tell you, we don't raise cattle. We raise grass.
The herds are on these ranches for half their lives. This is where they get food and shelter during the harsh winter.
I think it broadens an appreciation to know that, okay, this is a part of something a lot bigger than just our activities on the ranch.
We're on the edge of the Yellowstone ecosystem. You know, we're really part of it. Yeah, it's just a wild, wild place. Just living right in the wilderness area, just right above us, all around us. You know, we're surrounded by public land too, and it borders, and the elk move through it. And this fall, we had, you know, over 100 animals grazing. You kind of have to try to plan for that. You know, the fencing, we had to redo all of our fencing so that they don't get caught up in it, make it easy for them to move through. Being out there, seeing all this, being, you know, kind of sharing their habitat, listening to bull elk bugling out your backyard, it's good.
So this is where we start our journey, is down on these winter ranges. And these are some of the people we met at the beginning of that journey. You'll see a few other characters along the way. And the migration starts.
All right. So for me, I had never worked in a place I couldn't backpack. I typically was used to places I could drive up, throw my stuff in my backpack, go on a hike, and set up my cameras or go wait. But the Absarokas don't allow that to happen because you can't drive, you know, you can't get within 10 miles of some of these sites. And we need to carry a lot of stuff. We need food. Need all my cameras, we need lots of stuff. So these mountains are rugged, and here's some of the trails, the elk trails over these high mountain passes. There's three passes that are over 10,000 feet. Two of them are over 11,000 feet. This is big country. And I'd never ridden a horse either before, so I needed to learn how to do that too. And so we reached out to some of the local outfitters, you know, the guys that, I guess when I was younger, I was kind of intimidated of, you know, like you didn't want to have a conversation about wolves or something, you know. And now, you know, we end up spending 2 years with them. And it's an amazing experience to actually get to know people that, you know, maybe you disagreed with in a conversation years ago, but, you know, find common ground. And here's a short video of the two brothers we worked with.
Wes and I would be the first ones over the mountain into the thoroughfare.
It was a big adventure. I love to go see the elk, you know, in the spring. And then we follow it through the summer when we take our pack trips. We show people these beautiful herds of elk up on the high alpine meadows grazing. Then on the
those are steaks and spaghetti and all kinds of good stuff in there.
Elk. And then in the wintertime, I go capture elk and net gun out of the helicopter, put collars on them for this research project here. So it's pretty much a year-round thing that we're interacting with these elk.
Elk probably make up 85% of my fall income. Yeah, they're a driving factor in my life.
Hey, think about it. You're messing with them damn near year-round.
So these are the mountains that we're in. If you look in the middle of that frame, you can see 8 elk going up. This is Needle Mountain. Let me point them out. You can barely see them, but right here, there's 8 elk. So those elk are going up. This is fall migration, but this is the country, and it's rugged, it's remote. And so some of it we couldn't be on horseback.
Place where we have to cross an open, steep face that still has some snow on it. A lot of elk cross there. We really don't want to cross there.
So these elk are going across that face up there.
Look at those hoof prints. This elk track's all pounded through here.
And cut into the rock on the right of us.
Take your time on each foot.
So here's an elk at that same spot.
It's an incredible thing to see. I mean, we took us 2 years to get to. We got turned away from that mountain for 2 years by storms and by mudslides and by all kinds of things. But we finally got up there, and it's incredible to see what these animals are engaging in to get fresh green grass in the summer. To get to that, you got to go over a lot of mountains that look like this.
So, in addition to the mountain, or to going over that mountain to try to follow the path that the elk were going, we both spent a lot of time at the South Fork of the Shoshone River crossing. Because for me, I need to show these elk swimming rivers, and so I ended up spending about 2.5 months at this river crossing. So I'm going to share some photos from here and a short video. So we have an elk film coming out called Elk River that will premiere at Mountain Film Festival in a couple weeks. And this next short is an outtake from that 30-minute film. So I had to set up a blind. This was my only spot that I really hung out for a while and just waited for elk to come. And there was a lot of waiting. I mean, most of the day was waiting, but sometimes this would happen.
Close encounter with this bear that we didn't know we were having for about 4 hours. And then we knew we were having it. So these elk cross three mountain passes between 10,000 and 12,000 feet. Between them, they drop into deep river valleys, climb up the other side. Eventually, they crest over the Absaroka Divide, and they drop down into a region we know as the Thoroughfare. And what you're seeing here is part of Thoroughfare. In order to be there and for Joe to do his work and for me to see these animals on their summer range, I mean, one of the ways I've explained my urge to go and be there is that, you know, a lot of scientists get to work in petri dishes or cages. I work in the Greater Yellowstone Ecosystem, which is harder to see into. And if I want to see into it, I got to get on a horse and go there. And so that's what we were doing. We had a lot of Joe's junk to carry with us. And so over two summers, we spent a series of 2 and 3 week periods in the Thoroughfare with our guide, Wes, mostly, who you met earlier, looking for these large groups of summering elk from the herds that we had collared and worked with on their winter range. At one point,
he had a rule. Just let me, one note about this picture is he had a rule that you don't ever use soap in the backcountry, hence his hands. And because if you use soap, then you get an upset stomach. So you only use pine needles to wash things. So that's why his hands look like that.
I also once asked Wes, if he knew the country so well, why he needed the maps. And he said, well, the maps are just so I can prove to you that I know the country. This is Wes with his mule Rosie, who was a constant companion of ours and one of the most bizarre creatures either of us have ever met. David Quammen, the writer we spent some time with in Thoroughfare, called her Rosie the Campfire Mule. She loves campfires. She will burn her hair off standing near campfires. She sleeps in the wall tent with Wes a lot of nights. She likes to steal loaves of bread
and candy too.
Hamburger buns and bags of Werther's original lozenges or whatever they are. But that's Rosie. Stokes the fire when it's being poorly tended. That's David Quammen there, who we had the wonderful good fortune to spend a week with in Thoroughfare when he was working on the Yellowstone issue for National Geographic, which is just coming out now. And so this was important for me, spending time in Thoroughfare. This is the place where the sun and the rain and the snow come together to produce the grass that for me feeds these herds, it sustains these herds, and in many ways feeds this ecosystem. And that's what these animals are doing all summer up there, is they're resting and they are grazing all summer long. They'll gain 50, 75 pounds of fat. And that fat and that productivity is what sustains all these things in the system that we're talking about. It snows, yeah, in August, we've learned, up in the Thoroughfare. So we battled with a few snowstorms, hailstorms.
This was one of my favorite scenes, just because we had to stop because we were all soaking wet on July 27th. And conveniently, there was a patch of flowers that we stopped by, which is, for me as a photographer, is the absolutely perfect thing to put in front of these two individuals. And then the next frame is a picture that made it into the Geographic, that the issue actually comes out, I think, today.
Yeah.
Wes and Arthur. Uh-oh. Okay, so on to the camera trap work. That elk's gonna take the camera. All right, so, so for a lot of this work, just like my other work on migration, the camera trap is kind of my tool. It's, you know, there's no way that you can go up there and sit and watch when they're coming up on a trail. You'll blow them off the trail. If you're there when they're migrating, they're not migrating anymore. So that's why the camera trap is wonderful. On the other hand, working with camera traps in a remote place like this means, like for the example, this camera, this is a 3-day trip to set up this camera and then to check batteries, or if anything has licked it or touched it, like that's another 3-day trip, and I don't know if the camera's been hit or not. So I'm visiting these sites, sometimes with Arthur, sometimes alone, sometimes with a guide, consistently, and it just creates a whole nother layer of difficulty to get pictures like this compared to the deer and the pronghorn. So stuff happens like that, like this elk deciding it needs to taste it. So I'd come back and find, like, you know, this type of stuff. And
there's also, now, Joe, before you go to the next clip, there's also a lot of grizzly bears around here. A lot. I mean, we're seeing 30, 40, 50 grizzly bears in a trip when we go into the thoroughfare. And they present their own challenges for the camera trapper.
Yeah, and we luckily didn't have any that close. I mean, not once did we have a bluff charge, and most of the bears we encountered, we were on horseback, and luckily nothing happened there. But sometimes this only happened once, but this bear got a sight of one of my cameras, which are only little, but the front little glass element, you know, shows a reflection from the sky. So as the bear was walking by, I think she, you know, just saw it. And I guess all I can say is the camera didn't make it out of this one. But yeah. But then I ended up with some footage like this that is just, I mean, to me, is a dream come true to show these massive groups of elk going over almost 12,000 foot.
This is one of the, I said there are three passes they go over. This is the second of three. The first one you saw us walking over it.
So this would be at the end of July, or in mid-July. You can see this last elk has a broken leg. I don't know if we're thinking maybe she fell on one of the passes, or, I mean, possibly a wolf, but she probably won't make it. She'll be either wolf or bear food. But it just gets at the essence of this migration. It's not easy. These elk are risking a lot to do this, and it's worth it. Bunch of cubs. Uh-oh. Oops. So this frame, for me, really kind of brought it all together. I mean, this is the opening shot for the section on migrations in the Geographic article. And at first I thought it was something with wolves, then it's, you know, of course, then it's with bears, a bear eating an elk. Then I thought, you know, it's a big bull elk with snow maybe is the picture that, you know, the main picture that gets at the essence of this entire project. But now looking back at it, this is definitely the frame. It's all about the calves. And this is a spot that I worked both years, this, you know, little chunk of ground, 10 feet by 10 feet. I visited over 30 times, had about 400 miles of horseback all dedicated for this one image. And in late July in 2015, it all came together. The calves and the dust lifting up, the hot day, the mouth open, that calf's following its mother on its first migration. It, you know, it's learning the migration, the trail from its mother. It just, that to me is a dream photo.
So I mentioned earlier that one of my goals was to map the elk migrations of the Greater Yellowstone over the course of this work. And so a lot of that work, as I said, was to collaborate with the three states in this region and their wildlife biologists, two federal agencies, the Park Service and the Fish and Wildlife Service, that also manage and monitor elk. Turned out there was a lot of information there, but there were some gaps. We went out and filled those gaps with new collaring. And remarkably to me still, we were able to complete the map of these major migrations into and out of Yellowstone and the adjacent wildernesses. And so I'm going to show you that here. So why is this important? For me, this is important because we're looking in many ways at the veins and arteries of the Greater Yellowstone ecosystem. These migrations are what sustains a lot of the things that we care about in that landscape, both ecologically, economically, culturally. And so this was kind of a dream for me come true to be able to map for the first time in detail and comprehensively the movements of these animals in and out of that core landscape each year. So it's not just important because it's beautiful. I mean, I guess what I'm really trying to say there about the veins and arteries of the system is that this for me is a natural wonder of the Greater Yellowstone that people haven't yet recognized and acknowledged. It's a natural wonder as important, maybe more important than Old Faithful or the Grand Canyon of the Yellowstone. You just can't park your car next to it and watch it like clockwork. It happens in places that we can't see and access, and it happens fleetingly in the night and at a fast pace and is hard for us to see. So that's one reason why it's important, is that we need to know about this, and it needs to affect how we think about Yellowstone as a not a box on a map, but part of a larger ecosystem. The other reason why it's important is that we don't just get to keep this. Part of what we hope to see is a campaign going forward, or dedicated effort going forward, to conserve the migrations of the Greater Yellowstone and of the West. How do we go about doing that? Well, first of all, we got to have them on the map. So just think about, you know, the Red Desert to Hoback deer migration. Like Joe told you, it was there the whole time. It's happening. And even in 2012, put some collars on some animals down by I-80 thinking that they're just going to mill around in the Red Desert, and they move 150, 175 miles. Where else is this happening? I think the next thing is embedding these movements into our policies. People like Bob Kiter are going to be the people that help us understand how to do that. Currently, migration corridors are almost, with very few exceptions, have no place in state or federal, particularly land management policy. And that's a direction we need to be going in. If we want to conserve these migrations, which we've said by many means and in many ways that we do, we need to design landscapes to accommodate the movements of these animals. So Joe talked about addressing a particularly critical habitat and conserving it to make sure that these animals can move through it. We have people state agencies that have started building overpasses and underpasses into the landscape to facilitate the movements of these animals. And those are incredibly important. We have landowners, ranchers, working with land trusts in some cases to retrofit fences to be wildlife friendly. These are all great things, but we need to pick up the pace and we need to be doing these things, I think, at a significant scale if we want these migrations to persist. But I think the biggest lesson for us isn't kind of a technical fix or a set of, you know, ways in which we might be able to help these migrations by tweaking the landscape. Those are all important, but I think the biggest lesson has been you can't conserve a migration across 10, 15, 100 parcels of land owned by different people and agencies without all of those people being involved in that process. And that's a fundamental truth about migration and the way in which we are going to have to conserve it that I think speaks to conservation more broadly. And what I mean by that is it has to be partnership-oriented. And we have to figure out how to work across all these lines that we create in order to conserve these kinds of movements. What we tend to be really good at, in my experience in science and in conservation, is drawing lines, identifying differences among ourselves, and squabbling over them. What we tend to be less good at is having empathy, understanding people who are our neighbors in our communities, and working together with them to get something done around a common set of values. And I think for me, and I think for Joe too, that's been the biggest sort of shift for us and lesson for us from doing this work. We wouldn't have been able to do this project without a lot of support from a lot of people. So we have to thank all of them. We had support from all the agencies that have a stake in these migrations, who shared information, and a lot of folks, including many ranch owners and managers, who either helped us in the field or contributed funding to support our project. So I think with that, we will conclude and let you ask us any questions that you have. Thanks so much for letting us be with you today.
I have a microphone.
Your concluding maps and remarks lead me to this question. It's been several years since I've heard anything about a Yellowstone to Yukon migration project. What can you tell us about that?
Well, I'm afraid spending 2 years in the mountains of Wyoming, you know, walking the trail back and forth, I'm a little bit out of the loop on the latest developments there, except to say that I know that that effort is active and ongoing, and I think your question speaks to a broader and very wonderful evolution that's happening in science and conservation, where these corridors, you know, whether it's the corridor of 400 pronghorn, you know, from the Upper Green to Teton Park, or of tens of thousands of elk in and out of Yellowstone, or whether it's a continental corridor that's connecting parks and allowing many species to disperse and move freely. I think we're seeing, after a few decades of talking about corridors, a real dedication of a large community to, you know, manifesting those on the landscape. And certainly Yellowstone to Yukon's a big part of that.
And this project on elk and pronghorn and deer is a part of the Yellowstone to Yukon project. I mean, the Yellowstone to Yukon project is a massive continental, you know, like spine of the North American continent. And to say, well, we're going to protect that is, I mean, you got to zoom in a little bit, and this is zooming in, right? Yeah, well, last night when we arrived, we were driving from the airport looking up at the mountains wondering what's up there, and we don't know, but I'm sure there's something going on up there.
I've heard of several deer migrations. I know people have told me about in Utah that, not knowing the geography very well, I can't, and nor would I be an expert to relay back to you, but I think that there's an awareness, and actually this gets to something that I think we often want to make sure that we say about our work, is that people in a lot of places have some sense of these migrations locally. There's often somebody, whether it's a state wildlife biologist or a landowner, ranch manager who's been there a long time, native people who've been there even longer, who know something about one of these migrations. What we've and so the knowledge is there. I think the difference with our work is we've just been trying to use these tools to kind of underline the importance of these things and bring the story to a wider audience. So that's to say, we're not figuring it out. We're sort of building on all this knowledge that's already out there.
So do you know anything about the Elk Wildlife Refuge in right near Grand Teton? And they all sort of gather there. And is there any hope of restoring the corridor that they used to use?
That's a really good question. So the question is about the National Elk Refuge elk feed ground on in Jackson, right there by the Jackson Town site, which is one of 23 feed grounds, the other 22 being state run. The Elk Refuge is federally run and was the original feed ground. It was established in, I believe, the 19-teens, when we had eaten up so much winter range with development that there were significant die-offs of elk happening, and this public outcry led to this emergency action, which became annual, of feeding elk with hay. Other feed grounds, interestingly enough, were established in part to stop migration. I mean, not so much that one, but others in the Wind River Range, the Wyoming Range. Essentially what they do is they sort of short stop these animals from coming down fully onto the winter ranges, where they would consume forage that would otherwise be available to cattle, where they might transmit brucellosis, a disease they become a reservoir of since contact with cattle a long time ago. As far as, you know, what will happen in terms of the policy and management there, I think that there are some gradual reductions in feeding happening now. It's a very thorny issue, partly because, you know, of the sense that if you just stop feeding these animals, you might have a bigger management problem on your hands than you had in the first place. So there seem to be very slow incremental changes happening there, but I've now exhausted the extent of my current knowledge about what's happening on the feed grounds. But I think you mentioned the word restoring. I think that's one of the most interesting questions to me as an ecologist. We've really got deeply embedded in our heads now, those of us who think about, you know, conservation, the idea that you could restore large carnivores. You know, you put wolves back in Yellowstone, you reintroduce them in other places, but, you know, can we restore migrations? We essentially haven't tackled that question. And so there are bits and pieces of information here and there, I think, that suggest that sometimes they can come back, but it's not something I've seen significant work on.
Here's the mic.
Thank you. That was really a wonderful presentation. I was wondering, speaking of large carnivores, whether you were able to get any sense at all of how the large carnivores in the area plan for these migrations, and whether they move to or congregate in certain areas, or if you weren't able to do that, are you planning any research on that? Thank you.
Well, from the non-scientific point, there's bears that hang out in, you know, there's specific bears that were always in one spot along the migration trail. I'd get consistent bears. Not so much the wolves, because they can sense the camera traps, but the bears don't mind, you know, they don't avoid them. So, yes, I would get bears that, you know, that would just be hanging along the trail.
I think that I don't have significant research that I've done about it. Anecdotally, it seems like bears certainly are clued into these trails. You know, that could also be because they're a good way to travel through the country. But it does seem like, for instance, when we flew the route to get some of the aerial footage that you saw, you know, you do see quite a few bears up there in a place where there's no food to be had at that time of year other than elk coming through that what you could imagine might get bogged down in deep snow and become an easy prey when they otherwise are very difficult, adult elk are very difficult for bears to catch. I think the only work I've done that speaks a little bit to this question involves some wolf research where we found that it does seem like in the Clark's Fork herd, once the pups are somewhat mobile, the pack would establish the rendezvous areas that the pups, where the pups are stashed and hang out, closer to where the elk summer range was. And so, you know, they're prohibited, they're essentially blocked from migrating with those herds because of territorial boundaries, but they seem to be kind of positioning themselves closer to where all those elk went to. And so that was one thing that we did see.
But from, I guess from what I saw, I wouldn't say that the predators were having an impact on if the animals were migrating or not. I think the elk were going to make it to the thoroughfare no matter what. I mean, they were going, and it's not like there were so many bears or wolves, you know, sitting on the trail waiting, anything like that.
So you had a slide earlier about the mortality rate difference between the migrating and non-migrating elk. Do you have an idea or a feeling of what the percentage of non-migrating elk in the Yellowstone ecosystem is?
That's a really good question. I kind of didn't talk a whole lot about all that ecology here, but it varies really a lot by herd. So I showed you these 9 herds here, and I should have told you those herds contain anywhere from 2,000 to 10,000 animals each. So one of the extraordinary things you're looking at there is if you do a back of the envelope calculation, you're talking about maybe 10 million pounds of, you know, animal moving in and out of that landscape. But as far as the proportion of resident or non-migratory elk, you know, in the Clark's Fork herd, it's about half at this point, and that proportion's been growing. In the Jackson herd, I think it's similar, or at least if you short distance migrants and residents are maybe half or so of the herd. But there are other herds, like the Wiggins Fork herd or the Cody herd, where they're almost entirely migratory. And I couldn't speak, some of the others in Montana and Idaho I'm not as familiar with. It's It's not something that is actually very easy always to estimate, because in many of these herds, these animals co-mingle on winter range, and so it's hard to distinguish them at the time of year when they're typically counted. And so one of the things that we're trying to do, at least in the Wyoming herds, and there's a master's student I work with working on it, is using camera traps, the not fancy kind that Joe uses, Reconics and Browning and so forth camera traps, on these trails based on the GPS data to count and do classifications of migrating elk. And that's one way that we can start to parse out who migrates and who doesn't. But it varies a lot from zero to maybe half of each herd.
And the best guess for total migratory elk in the system is about 25,000.
Probably 25,000. The other thing is there are other herds down in the Wind Rivers that I couldn't speak to, but they probably contain more residents than the ones we're talking about here.
Given the time, I think maybe it's difficult to say that. What an extraordinary presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you
very
much.
Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you.